grab the script right in front of me and just write. You can take it with you to the other movie.
There it is.
So, I'm good.
All good?
Yep.
Good evening, citizens and staff. I am Mayor Kara Westfall, and I hereby call to order this council meeting on Tuesday, January 17th, 2023. The time is 7:03. Roll call, please.
Councilor Steinberg?
Here.
Councilor Blaine?
Here.
Councilor McClung?
Here.
Councilor White?
Here.
Please stand and join me.
To the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have some certificates of service for Kenny Dresden.
Dresden?
Not here. Kenny, we will make sure he gets this, but he has been with the city of Klamath Falls for 15 years, and so we have a, in the Public Works Department, Maintenance Division. So we will make sure he gets that, and we really appreciate his service. Alan Harris. Well, the city of Klamath Falls has a certificate awarded to Alan Harris, Public Works Department, Water Distribution Division, for the completion of 30 years of service on January 1st, 2023. So we will make sure he gets that. Klamath Community College has a presentation. We have Chip Massey. Come on up to the podium.
Thank you very much, and actually, if you're okay, I'm going to defer to our president, Dr. Roberto Gutierrez, since he was able to attend this evening, to do a little bit of an opening for us, and then I'll follow up with a presentation.
Wonderful, thank you.
Sir.
Hello there.
Council members, again, Roberto Gutierrez is my name, I'm president of Klamath Community College. I've been in this community for about a decade, about 10 years now. I think some of you...
Okay, thank you. Yeah. I don't have to repeat it, right?
No.
I think some of you seen the latest data that was presented at the Ross Ragman about a week or so ago. Okay. Some of you have been here long enough to know that those are good numbers. We still have a long ways to go, but boy, 10 years ago when I got here, what a change. That didn't happen by accident. It doesn't happen by just good luck or whatever. It happens by all of us working together, by caring about this community, having common goals, common vision. And that's how change happens. When I got here 10 years ago, I looked at the data, and at that time, we had the worst high school dropout rate in the state. Klamath Community College had the worst DEVET rate in the state. That means that the majority of our students were not academically prepared. It's hard to attract business and industry with those kind of numbers. They want a well-trained, well-educated workforce. They don't want to retrain their workers. They want the community to be prepared. So what they did, I'm going to use the pilot analogy, they just flew on by. We were flyover country. They went on to Bend, Portland, other areas. They didn't stop. Well, I'm happy to report that we turned that around. We now have one of the best. Now, this is before COVID, so that data is a little bit old, 3 or 4 years old. But we have one of the best high school dropout, I mean, high school success rates in the state now. KCC is, we turned that from one of the worst as far as DevEd to 60% or so less now. Now, we're always going to have a little bit because we're open access. You know, the community college system in the United States is an American idea of higher ed. We don't pick and choose. Yeah, we'll take the valedictorians and all that. No, we don't do that. We're open access. We work with anybody that comes to us. We're always going to have a little bit, but not like before. We were the largest high school in the state. So we had students that came to us at that time for a program. It took almost a year to get ready for for, you know, for the academics. Well, this is 100 level and above. And then they got into the program. Now the two-year program was a three-year program. Now they were more in debt and so on. But that's behind us now. We definitely have made an improvement. Again, it doesn't happen by happenstance. It happens by all of us caring about this community. So yes, that has a positive, you know, effect. It lowers our crime rates. Whenever there's good jobs that come here, you know, whenever we attract business and industry because we have a well-educated, well-trained workforce, you know, our crime rates go down. Klamath Falls is a good place to raise a family. Parks and so on. So that's where we're at today. Now we have to improve. We still have some families in poverty, but we've come a long ways. So thank you for working with Klamath Community College, you know, to really make Klamath Falls fulfill its potential. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, okay, now to the meat and potatoes of it.
Okay.
There we go. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. All right. So I wanted to, tonight, I wanted to share with you, we shared some information to you, and hopefully you've had a chance to review some of that information. Are we able to do the...
The presentation's the last one.
And if not, I can punt.
It's all right, we're getting it.
Yeah. I thought I'd just go through kind of quickly the highlights of what we presented.
Thank you, Scotty.
Automatically running, or is it?
He's gonna.
First slide.
Yeah.
One more. So thank you, and then we'll move on to the vision. Thank you very much. So I'm here tonight just to share a few of the bullet points, and that's what I have in this presentation. It's not different than what you have in front of you. All the same basic information, and hopefully. I'll answer a few questions as we go forward. Next slide, please. Oh, I'm sorry, vision was fine. Excuse me, didn't realize you were there. So, the whole project was originally conceived as part of a feasibility study back in 2016. So, there were a number of things that the community identified that KCC could bring that would be helpful, that would help the community move forward. And one of them was the Work Skills Technology Center, which is one of the buildings that is on campus that was built a little over five years ago. Mm-hmm. And then Founders Hall as a place for everybody to gather and students to have all of their services in one place. And then the last part was a facility that would be supporting trades, the professional development of firefighters, law enforcement, emergency medical technicians, big, broad, long list. Well, that finally became the KCC Apprenticeship Center project. And we've been working since that time to raise the funds and to move this forward. And the whole idea was to be able to provide a hands-on training facility, a place that students could go and actually swing a hammer, get work on welding, to do manufacturing, all of those things in one place in kind of a shared space. This is part of the master plan at KCC, and the Board of Education has approved it. And I must admit that the County Building Department is already allowing us to open portions of the building. So really what I'm here tonight to talk about is where we are, and then we do have an ask. We're going to be requesting some support from the city for this project as well. The big things on the list were create a large industrial shop space to offer hands-on training and pre-apprenticeship for high school students, so they could be taking a pre-apprenticeship program in high school, share the facility on our campus, and then move into our apprenticeship programming. And we wanted to be able to provide non-credit short-term workforce training that led to certificate or licensing in trades-related fields. We want to be able to offer professional development for our fire professionals and our emergency medical technicians here locally. We want to be able to expand our current and pre-apprenticeship programming across the state, including plumbing, electrical, pipe fitting, millwright, eventually a full HVAC program also with licensing and certification. We always want to hear, and I think you may have heard a little more about this in your work session prior to tonight's meeting, entrepreneurship and small business development, how huge that is and how we can be training people to move into that. We want to be able to connect our regional industries and the local contractors and local businesses with students and help them recruit good workers for the future. Provide some internships, do some of the work experience training models that we've been following up on. We also wanted to make sure that our local and regional fire districts had a place to train. So this started partly under the Public Safety Committee at KCC with all of the fire departments and everything working. What do we really need? So I must admit, there's a four-story fire tower there, nearly the tallest building in Klamath Falls, if I'm close to having that right. I think there's only a couple of buildings that are taller than four stories. So we actually are changing the skyline at KCC as well. We also we're going to be reciting our high school equivalency program. The HEP program is focused on GED for migrant seasonal farm workers. And one of the goals is having them in this space to see the transition to the other kinds of things that they can be doing once they've gotten their GED. So we're excited about all of the opportunities that are coming our way in this program. Next, please. So progress so far. You can see there in the upper right, the big bear, here's all of the metal and nothing underneath. And then on the lower left, that was actually just a couple weeks ago, you can tell by the snow, there is actually nearly a full-fledged building standing up out there, 30,000 square feet of building that will be housing all of our apprenticeship programs and will bring welding back to KCC's campus. Up to this point, we've been sharing welding at OIT. They've been very nice and a great partner in that, but they also wanted the space for their civil engineering. And so they were happy to see the welding move back down to us so they could expand into that space there. Once it's fully realized, we really, really expect that we'll be serving over the next 10 years about 3,000 additional students into the workforce. That's our goal in trades, in welding, in advanced manufacturing, in professional development, in actual fire sciences, and moving students into the firefighting programs around our community. The other thing is we currently are already employing an awful lot of people and getting the building stood up. And the one thing I will say, we work very hard at KCC to make sure our local contractors have a shot at the bidding process and to build the buildings. And I would say thank you, Dr. Gutierrez, for making sure that we can do that, that our local contractors are competitive, and we do have local folks who are working on this project there. We are in the last mile, almost literally. About half of the building is already approved for use. We still have some equipment to purchase. We still have some capital construction to take place that we're trying to close the gap on. Here, if we can go to the next one. I've shared some of this with you. I'm going to give you just another one little brief touch on this, and then we're going to move on to the expenses. One of the things I hadn't mentioned is that we've increased our number of the BOLI registered apprenticeships at the college from 3 to 8. So in addition to electrician, plumbing, and millwright, we've added carpentry, drywaller, cement mason, interior, exterior specialist, and painter to our apprenticeship programs that all lead to journeyman status in the construction industry. Next slide. So basically, total cost of the project, construction, the actual capital construction of the building, and then the equipment, a total of $11,500,000, a little over, a little bit of change there. And this gets us to the request. We know that there has been investment from around the community, and we're hoping that the city of Klamath Falls will join in. Our request is for a $100,000 contribution to this project to help us close this gap. And we'll talk a little bit more about the gap here at the end and what we're working on. And I'll share a little bit of our successes in this also. And I do have colleagues who can help answer questions as needed as well, if there are any. But really, the reason that we ended up at $11.5 million instead of $8.9 million when this project started pre-pandemic, there have just been budgetary increases throughout. Inflation, the addition of some expanded project there, the lingering impacts of the pandemic itself. Some of the things that we were doing have been slowed down because of the supply chain issues, all of which added cost, and in the end really, really pushed our number over the $11 million mark after an initial budget of a little over $8 million when we began the project. Next slide, please. So to date, we have actually raised a little over $10 million of the $11.5 million project. That leaves just about 1.4 that we're working on. We have a path forward. I must admit, one of the paths is getting other organizations to help us with this, to help bring this gap a little closer to being finished. But we are working with a variety of agencies and organizations. We are in the midst of our Build the Basin campaign, which is really a public-focused campaign. So the Build the Basin campaign had a goal, a short-term goal of $300,000. We're a little ways over the two-thirds mark on that goal. We think we have a path to actually getting to the $300,000 and maybe a little beyond. And so that would take a little bit off of this as we're doing that. We are also working with some other organizations, including the Economic Development Administration, who is one of our main funders in the beginning. You can see that in the paperwork that you have. They were in for $3 million, but also recognized there had been some cost increase. And they gave folks who had projects in the pandemic an opportunity to come back and ask for additional funding. We've actually asked them for almost $900,000. We're not sure that number is going to be given to us, but we think that we're pretty cautiously optimistic. With the EDA, that's always a dangerous thing to say, but we are cautiously optimistic that they will come through with some dollars to help us. But we know we're still going to be out there working to continue to close that gap and pay for it. The importance of actually having the entire facility paid for when we start is we don't owe anything on it, and it's sustainable. And we can begin to put students into it, and we can really focus on programming and student success as we go forward there. I'll touch on a couple of the other large contributors to the project. The Higher Education Coordinating Commission, through a state bond, has provided $3.9 million. The EDA funds were part of a match to that. Another $900,000 was coming from the college through our fundraising efforts to manage that. One of the wrinkles with the money from HEC has to be matched dollar for dollar. So anytime you get those monies at a community college from the state, you have to actually match dollar for dollar. Why don't we go to the next slide? Prosperity potential. The thing that I didn't share in the paperwork I gave you was what we're seeing is the outlook for the people who are going to be graduating from the programming in the apprenticeship center. So construction laborers right now are earning anywhere from $12.59 at the low end to about $26.80 at the high end in construction. Carpenters up to $32 and commercial truck drivers about $29 an hour working going forward. These are good paying jobs. They will help support families, and they put people on a path that will be an improved career, and they can continue working on their education if they choose to, but also could choose to open their own businesses, could choose to become part of the community in a variety of ways beyond just being in the construction industry. Having said all of that, next slide, I'll see if there's any questions.
I did tour the facility, and it is fabulous. And hearing the stories of your students working and earning was fabulous. So
well,
that's great.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Councilor.
Has the city contributed funds prior to this?
No. And it, I'll share, this is our first ask to the city. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, that was way too easy. So, yeah.
Very good. Any more questions or comments? Okay, well, thank you so much.
Thank you. And we're happy to follow up with any information you might need. And funding can be between capital and or equipment, depending upon the potential for the contribution.
Excellent. Okay, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Great presentation. All righty. So at this point, we have a public comment. And I wanted to read the public comment guidelines. So public comment is a time for citizens to present information to the city, and if based on what is presented, additional information is needed and or answers warranted by the city. Citizens will be contacted by the appropriate city staff and or future agenda item will be scheduled for further discussion. Public comment is not a time to set for questions and answers. If councilors have questions, they will be presented to staff or the speaker at another time. So at this time, we will call up, we have two that have signed up, Jennifer Lucas.
So I did find Mayor Westfall's statement online from last time, so that was good that I found it. I did, however, find that what it did was attempt to deny that the Equity Task Force was meant to establish a permanent committee. Proof of this is found first in a letter to those asked to be part of this task force, quoting, "You will lay the groundwork and scope for a permanent body of citizens to assist the council in enacting these solutions." And second, in the resolution that was unanimously passed in section 2, line 5, it says, moving forward, City Council will accomplish this by continually seeking opportunities to restore and expand equity in collaboration with the Equity Task Force, Standing Equity Committee, and the broader community. Also found it interesting that this you chose to finally make a statement once the members, three of the members of the task force had left, including Joey Gentry, who has continually fought for our community and challenged you left town. Your pledge that this council would be the one to consider equity in all of your decisions while ignoring the pleas of the many people your decisions directly affect is presumptuous, privileged, and ignorant. Please take a look at the seated council. Have any of you ever faced racism, prejudice, or discrimination? How can you claim to know what is good for these people when you can't even be bothered to listen to them? All we want is to create a safe, thriving, welcoming community with opportunities for all, and you should want the same, but you must consider perspectives other than your own. I also found out today that others in the community were counting on the Equity Committee to help in their decision-making, including Klamath Falls Head Start. So for over a year, citizens of Klamath Falls, your constituents, took time to come in and tell you of their experiences and beg you to do as you promised. The representation they seek is a committee that you disbanded in secret, and we will continue to speak out until you keep your word. And even if it's only me, I guess I will continue to speak out. So, all right, that's all I have to say.
Thank you.
And thank you. Would you like to submit your statement?
It's a mess, but sure.
Okay. City Recorder will take that. Thank you. Next, Kurt Martin.
I gave Nicole a couple copies if you guys like a hard copy. Before I start at Klamath Community College, I graduated there. I'm a licensed contractor in Klamath Falls, and I'm a CDL holder, so it's a really cool program that they have going on. I'd like to see you guys continue helping them out. regardless, I am not here for that. I am here representing Dan Martin Construction in the matter of the Hidden Valley subdivision and the Sierra Heights pump station owned by the city of Klamath Falls. In 2004, Klamath County approved a tentative plan for Sierra Heights subdivision. The Sierra Heights water pump station was constructed, permitted, and inspected by the city of Klamath Falls to provide water for the entirety of the subdivision. Since then, 62 homes have been built in phase one, and another 46 lots remain phase two. In 2010, the city of Klamath Falls created a master water plan, allocated $200,000 to upgrade the Sierra Heights pump station. None of those funds have yet been utilized. Since 2018, phase two of the Hidden Valley subdivision, previously known as the Sierra Heights subdivision, has been waiting final plat approval from the city of Klamath Falls. They are unwilling to sign the final plat because they claim an improvement is needed to the pump station or a new one needs to be constructed. While waiting for final plat approval, Dan Martin Construction has hired multiple engineers to understand the claim that the improvements are in fact a necessity and lawyers to help them understand the legality of the city's ability to deny water to phase two of the project. Dan Martin Construction feels they have a strong argument, both the engineering and the legality of the matter, but we are here to make sure the City Council is aware of the situation and help assist Dan Martin Construction moving forward. We understand the City of Klamath Falls is our community, and we wish to come to a resolution that everyone benefits, that doesn't have any more unnecessary delays, and doesn't waste any more city resources. We are here to help and ask you to continue the route for the conclusion of this matter. You, our City Council members, are our last hope at doing this. I am here to ask the City of Klamath Falls Council members to place the matter of the Sierra Heights pump station onto the next council's agenda to further explore the funding of this pump station that the city requests in order to sign the final plat for the Hidden Valley subdivision. Thank you.
Thank you. Here's this. Anybody else wishing to speak in on public comment during this time? And anybody online? Okay, seeing and hearing nobody else, we will close. Consent agenda. 5.1, the approval of consent agenda, meeting agenda, prior meeting minutes from January 3rd, 2023, provided under separate cover in items 5.2, 5.3, and 5.4. Action 5.2, rebuilding American infrastructure with sustainability and equity raise grant for the East Main Bypass Project. 5.3, concurrence on members of the Audit Oversight Advisory Committee 2023. And 5.4, December 2022 project update for the wastewater treatment plant upgrade.
I'll move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. General public hearing 6.1, in ordinance amending City Code Section 2470B concerning the composition of the Marijuana Advisory Committee, first reading. City Attorney Michael Swanson.
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, Council. Have it turned up high enough? Here to talk basically this housekeeping matter. Before I forget, I did have a meeting. The marijuana advice. I'm gonna stand up here.
It's fine. It's actually fine. It's not that bad on the reverberation of the audio. But go ahead. And they have copies of your amended ordinance.
Okay, great. We were finally able to get a quorum for the marijuana advisory committee today, so they were able to go over this ordinance as well. And that is part of the reason why there's an amendment to the amendment that's actually in the packets. Just to make the record nice and clear, I'm going to go ahead and read how the proposed language should be now. I'm going to read it as it should be. I'm going to skip over the cross-out part. The new proposed language for 2.470B of the city code is the mayor, with the concurrence of the city council, shall appoint seven individuals to the committee, with a minimum of 5 being city residents and a maximum of 2 county residents if the county residents own a marijuana-related business within the city limits. The majority of members shall be Oregon license holders, license applicants, or individuals otherwise knowledgeable of the marijuana industry. One member shall be chosen from the Planning Commission. And the reason for this change is because, as originally proposed, it was against our charter. Our charter is very clear that you have to be a city resident to be on a board or a committee. And obviously, originally when it said there could be 2 possible county residents, and it was that open, it was just in violation of charter. However, under Section 5 of the charter, it is considered that the charter should be liberally construed, and also it does give council the ability to interpret the terms of their own charter, or your own charter, pardon me. Previously, as I mentioned in the report, we have the parking district downtown. The parking district does allow for non-city residents to be on it, provided that they own a business or property within the parking district. And so I based the change to the marijuana advisory committee upon that interpretation. As I noted, that section had been drafted all the way back in 2011 and was amended in 2017, so it predates quite a few of us here in the room as far as the interpretation of resident for the purpose of a committee or a board. So basically, I'm coming before the council and suggesting that the ordinance, specifically Section B of 2.470, be amended as proposed in order to make sure that it coincides with what our charter requires. If there's any questions on that?
Questions, comments? At this point, I would like to open it up for a public meeting or public hearing. Anybody wishing to speak on this item? And seeing and hearing nobody, we will close that public hearing. Go ahead.
And actually, forgive me, I think I did mention this. The Marijuana Advisory Committee's advice was to go ahead and adopt it as amended. I don't remember if I said that.
No. Perfect.
I would move to approve the ordinance as proposed to amend City Code Section 2.470B and introduce the ordinance for first reading by title only.
Second. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? City Manager, please read the ordinance by title only.
6.1, an ordinance amending City Code Section 2.470B concerning the composition of the Marijuana Advisory Committee. First reading.
Very good. Thank you. Other matters. 7.1, Klamath Falls Little League 2-inch water service request. And we have Water Manager Robbie West reviewing his written report in detail.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of council. I'm here tonight for other matters. As most of you probably remember, I was here 2 weeks ago. The gentleman from Klamath Falls Little League, Frank Hullock, came to speak to you guys about requests for 2-inch water. So I put together a little agenda item to show some of the past history and some of the comparables from the past. A couple of things I'll point out is the city has done this once before in the past with Klamath Falls BMX. We did assist them in the past. They were looking at a 1-inch meter, whereas the baseball field looking at 2-inch, just simply because of the volume we're using. We did partner with the county on that one. In this particular time, the county, I believe, is a property owner, is doing some other improvements to the infrastructure and not looking at the meter itself. So if we decide to move forward with anything on the meter, it would probably be city solely contingent on the city moving forward. One note I always like to point out is the largest portion of this fee is the SDCs. And as some of you may or may not know, SDCs cannot be waived. They also can't be paid out of the water fund. That's part of the reason they come to you guys and they have to come out of the general fund. Can't pay a water SDC from the water fund. Obviously, it doesn't go well with our tax portions of it. And then the last part is they did at one point request maybe some sort of funding for one-time forgiveness on the water bill. That's something that we typically don't do. I have not been privy to that in my time here. Water rates, as I said, are set at the beginning of the year. I will mention if you guys do have questions or if that's an avenue you guys want to look at, if you have J.W. Kenny, our meter services managers here, to discuss that as well. And also, Commonwealth will leave the density. I think the biggest thing was trying to share the information, what we're looking at. the options that the city could move forward with, and more than anything, just looking for maybe a recommendation from you guys for staff to move forward. Obviously, it's a big decision, but so can I get answer any questions you might have initially.
Very good. Any questions or comments? How many Little League, or probably you don't know, but Little League children are out there playing? If you can come up to the podium, please.
Last year, thank you, Council. Mm-hmm. Frank Albert, President of Little League. Last year, we had between 800 and 900, right about 842, I believe, mm-hmm. which was one of our best years that we've had for respondents, kids coming out. So we are supporting that for through the summer, through spring, summer, and we do have fall programs that we're mm-hmm. trying to work with. So I would say anywhere from 7 to 8, 9 months out of the year is being used. Doug White is maintenance out there, helps us out. And we try to leave the field open so kids have something to do during the summer to go ahead and play games out there or just go out and field a ground ball, stay active, and just like what they were talking about earlier at KCC, what are communities trying to do to build a complex to bring the infrastructure to get it up to par to where it's safe for kids to play out there, but also to bring in tournaments on weekends and bring funding and bring some type of money to Klamath, and so that we have a ball field that people are interested in playing that and talk about. We have people that are looking at, we've reseeded thanks to John Lindsay. Some of the courses, if you looked at the map, you see how brown it is. We got some of it back, but we need the water. This is everybody does, but we need it to get the grass back up. The dirt blows away. The fences become unsafe. But what we're trying to do is have something that people talk about, and they come here. And Steens is a great place as well. We're trying to work with them to have more tournaments to bring in people. So it is, if we don't get this, it's going to go away just as Babe Ruth Fields went away and they turned it into an archery range. And as like I said, KCC is talking about, you know, how we're trying to build a community and more people are coming. We're trying to provide something for our kids. And it has been very well. We've succeeded over the last couple of years to build our program, but now if we don't get this, it's going to go away. We work very hard just to keep it up to where it is playable, but it's constant work all summer long. It's a year-round job. Mm-hmm. And the council, or the committee that we have now, is working very hard to get fundraising and bring this, and I have a meeting with the county to bring a little bit more funding to complete the project. But it starts here with the meter. If we don't get the water, we're done. Mm-hmm. There's nothing to stranded.
Right. And my grandson, I went out there for the very first time. He plays out there, and I was very impressed at the amount of people and just the way you had everything organized and people were moving around very, very well. But having green grass is important. So I appreciate you doing that.
It's a safety issue. It's the biggest problem. Mm-hmm. Thank you for your time.
Yeah. And another thing, too, is getting sponsorships from you know, the car dealerships and other places so that you can put, you know, get more people involved so that this, so we can really get some momentum going.
We have a fundraising committee that, and they're working on, besides the money or sponsors for teams, we're looking at other people that just want to donate to Little League because of their grandchildren or their children. It's just, we've been successful, but we just don't want to see it flounder.
Very good.
And it is a big ask, and I understand that, but we need your help.
So. Super. Any more questions? Councillor Blaine.
This might be a question for Robbie, actually.
Okay.
Well, actually, probably Jessica, but In our budget, I mean, in our general funds, I guess, what's our latitude right now? Where are we at?
I'd say I was going for
that. Yeah.
City manager.
Yeah, and Jessica's not here. I'm trying to recall when we did the BMX track, I believe that we had taken that out of our general funds, mm-hmm. is how we had funded that in the past and for the SDCs.
Okay. I'm generally in support of the Little League, and I've been on the field. I have a kid that played. It is a larger ask than what we've done before. Yeah.
It's not that, and I just, so you guys have all the information, because that's my job, really, to make sure you guys have it. There is a line in here that talks about under financial impacts that if they do not need the 5/8 meter, there could be part of an SDC credit. For that, typically, if a customer has a meter and we upsize to a different one and they remove the old meter, we do an offset of credit. So in this case, it's about a $3,500 credit of that. But I have spoke with Little League, and because of the location of that meter, and the fact that meter feeds the restrooms and the snack bar, their hope is to keep that meter as well. So I just want to point that out, because it does say in the financial facts that it could be a reduction of cost. I don't think that would happen at this time. I think it would be looking to keep that as well, just so you have the full numbers.
Thank you.
Councilor McClure.
It might be more of a comment, just that I would love to support it. I'm new on this council. I haven't participated in a complete budget cycle yet, so I appreciate Councilor Blaine asking the question about the general fund. And I would be in support of that if the city can afford to do that at this time, but not having participated in an entire budget cycle yet,
and
I hesitate to be the one to.
Well, I appreciate the thought and words on that. Doug, you might have to mention it.
I'm Doug. You
have to come to the podium, please.
So I've lived here all my life. I played Little League baseball over at Fairgrounds. So they got rid of those fields and enlarged them, and at that time, we had City Little League Field and South Suburban Little League Field. So approximately 10 years ago, they did away with all the City Little League Field. So we agreed to take City on, and it would become Klamath Falls Little League. So initially, fields were built for Little League for a safe place for the kids to play. Not about the uniforms, not about the concession stand. It's a safe place for kids to play. It is no longer safe. We went through drought years. Probably 15 years ago when I was on the board, we had to replant the field because of the drought. 2 years of no water from the irrigation, and the fields are so unsafe, kids are getting hurt. Now we have insurance, but you get about 5 kids to get teeth knocked out from balls hitting tufts of grass, and you can guarantee they shut you down. And it got so bad last year, we had parents take it on themselves to turn it into their insurance. And I finally said, we're past the point of safe. There's not going to be any more baseball here. At the end of the year, which was a few weeks later after the last accident, we started watering with half-inch hoses and moving them every 2 hours just to get 4 fields and replanted the fields. You know, for the kids to have a place to play this year, but if there's no water, you know, as much moisture as we're getting out here right now, it doesn't guarantee we're going to get irrigation. Which we will use the irrigation whenever we can. But if we don't have it, no more Little League. And I really believe, because I've watched Babe Ruth go away because of water. They let them pump out of a county drainage ditch, if you look into it. Somebody in the county decided that was not going to happen anymore. There was no more water. There's 2 perfectly good fields that could be fixed over there. There's an archery range on one. So we've been trying to take the place, and we actually have 3 Babe Ruth teams. They call them senior teams. And they're playing up at Steen, and we paid for that out of our budget. We do have room to put other fields in, but we don't dare do it. You know, we talked for years, but nobody ever took it on to get extra water that we could use when we can't get irrigation. And you can't count on it anymore. But literally, you're going to see, and it's not just 800 kids. We had 800 and some kids from here signing. We had kids from Lakeview coming here to have somebody to play, Altura. So it's more than that. And it'll all go in again. We lost. I mean, we're right there. You know, we talked about it 27 years ago. We need to drill a well. We need to do this. We never do. And this just bugged me in. Thank God for this man. Because I'm no good at paper. But we do need it if you want the kids to have this to go on. They've taken all the base, most of the baseball fields out of the little, at the schools and stuff. You know, that's where you used to play minor ball. Well, most of the baseball fields went away, and they're not there. And if they were because of the COVID, you could get on the schools anyway to play. We've had one summer league. We want to have more. But we can't because of the abuse that the fields take, and with no grass, it's dangerous. Anyway, that's all I got to say. We really need it as soon as we can get it in so we can, if we don't get irrigation, last year they told me we get irrigation, I don't know. And I know there's going to be a lot of little kids. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Counselor.
Counselor.
I just have a comment also. I want to commend you for being willing to partner with Steens, because that was one of the questions I had, was how are we partnering, or how are you partnering with other places that are similar? So kudos to that. I think partnership is one of the key things that'll keep Klamath improving. Again, I'm with Abby. I really want to vote on this, but I'm brand new, and I don't want to keep using that flag, but I fully support these sort of things, green spaces, recreation, things like that. And I really do believe that the city should be supportive in those efforts. So personally, I don't feel comfortable making the motion, but I'm in full support if our senior counselors are supportive of it.
I'm a big supporter of Little League, and I'm more than comfortable making the motion. So I would move to forward.
Just a moment. More than welcome to, but I think, Mike, I'm just talking. At this point, we're looking more just for direction, and that's
okay.
If you guys want us to work, I don't mind meeting with Jessica and planning out budget, putting something together as a project. Sorry, Jonathan and Mike, to get back with you guys.
That's fine.
Feel free to big motion if you want. But just, I didn't want to cut you off. But.
Perfect.
Well, I heard a comment about we need to do it as quickly as possible to get the grass grown.
And that is, we're waiting for this to happen so we can start construction. As soon as you get the okay to do it, we're going to start with the rest of the donations that we have. Like I said, I have a meeting with county commissioners tomorrow at 1 o'clock and to get the funding to start the construction on this. It's going to bring revenue, like I said, working with Steens and that, it's going to bring people to the Klamath for baseball all summer long. It is, I mean, I appreciate your guys' concern, and I'm thankful for it very much so.
Very good. Thank you. City Attorney, or City Manager.
Madam Mayor, Council, it does seem to be a larger, broader discussion seems to be needed on this subject. I know that it's just in my short time here, we've had discussions with Steen Sports Parks about water, with Kiger Stadium about water, with the BMX track about water, and now here with the Little League fields. And I don't know if that looks like a park district or, but there needs to be a broader discussion about how this continues to get funded, I believe.
Very good. And I believe the ask was just the one-time pipe situation. It wasn't going to be ongoing, I don't believe.
No, I gave you guys some options that I saw that could be feasible. One is to, you know, support putting the 2-inch meter in. One would be if we just want to do a one-time donation, you know, or any, we're open to any direction you guys have as far as that. I mean, it's really, truly up to you guys. I can't really advocate for it as the water manager. I'm just trying to give you as much info.
Very good.
The one thing is, if you guys, you know, aside from what City Manager has mentioned, if you guys do want me to work with Jessica and get more information and get some things together for next meeting, I have no problem. I have to be at the next one anyway. I can put something together again and bring in more information.
So do we have the consensus with everybody? Councillor Blaine?
Yeah,
What is your thought?
I mean, like I said, I am generally supportive of this. It's not a big number. I think my bigger concern is what Jonathan just brought up, is how do we continually, we're seeing these requests over and over, and we are not, you know, at some point those general funds go away, right? And we need to be fiscally responsible as well. So it's not that I'm not supportive of this. $30,000 isn't that much. I'd like to see the actual numbers from Jessica and the budget, but it brings up a larger concern for me.
Councillor Studenberg?
Yeah, I'm in support of you pursuing it, and I would like to get the numbers from Jessica, but you've got my support for the concept, and let's put it together and bring it back to us.
Very good. Thank you so much for all of your work. Appreciate that. Okay. Anything other on other matters? Anybody else?
Madam Mayor, yeah.
Go ahead.
If I could provide an update on the F-15 display.
Sure.
And, mm-hmm. and provide maybe a little bit of background too. Staff, with council's approval, has been working on bringing the F-15 display to fruition since 2018. So last May, on May 16th, council allocated funds for this project to be located within Veterans Park. Council later approved a memorandum of understanding between the city and the county for funding support. At that same June council meeting, council approved a design services contract with ZCS Engineering. The design is now complete, and we're waiting word to proceed with the actual construction work. At the last City Council County Commissioner joint meeting, Commissioner Dave Hensley and I were appointed to explore several options of locating it elsewhere or alternate locations. And these included city parks. We explored the county fairgrounds and Kingsley Field. And after assessing various proposed locations, it's our recommendation that the display be located at Veterans Park, as was authorized in the original motion. And as a backup location, our recommendation would be the county fairgrounds as a backup location. If the council wants to authorize by motion the placement of the display at Veterans Park, it may, but the board had previously taken action to locate the project at that specific location and did so in their motion, so it's not necessary either.
Would anybody like to place a motion or just leave it at that? Leave it?
If I could add, what was the downside to the county fairgrounds?
Why was that looked at as the alternate location?
Yeah.
It was felt that was probably the next most visible location for the display. We felt that Veterans Park would be the most visible for the public and those
okay.
coming through town, but as a second location, probably thought that would be the next best
okay.
location for that.
Thanks.
Okay, so everybody's good with Veterans Park? Or leaving it at that? Councillor? No?
I have a lot of understanding to do on this topic. I've been watching the live streams and listening to the public comments, so those decisions were made before I was elected to council, so I would say leave it at that.
Very good. Okay. Go ahead, Councillor.
I was just going to second what Abby's saying. I've spoke to previous council members, and I feel like with us being so new to this role, I'd like to respect the previous motions as well.
Very good. All righty. Thank you. Anybody else for anything on other matters? Okay. Adjournment?
Is there, just for clarity, is there any need to adjourn into executive session?
Madam Mayor, Council, if I could ask that we could adjourn into executive session for a brief discussion related to the sale or purchase of city property.
And I've got the ORSs right here if you'd like me to put on the record.
And okay, so we will adjourn into executive session under ORS 192.6602, real property transaction, E, real property transactions, and H, consultation with legal counsel. Thank you.